Welcome back to our lecture on applied mathematical finance and its object-oriented implementation. And in today's session, we will maybe look a little bit more to the implementation side of our interest rate model. So we have started a section on interest rate models. And I started here talking about a big model that we then implement with numerical methods, that is Monte Carlo and a numerical scheme, or like Euler scheme for the time discretization, which models a discretization of the forward rate curve. So we model a large vector of forward rates. That allows us to value almost any interest rate derivatives, maybe given that we have an interpolation for rates which are not in our discretization. Yeah, so we haven't talked yet about interpolation, but that will come up as a separate topic. And this here is to some extent the model that was formerly known as LIBOR market model, or which is for historical reason called LIBOR market model. Yeah, because that forward rate is the convention that was used in the London Interbank Offer Rate. And we already introduced the model. We derived the drift under the risk neutral measure corresponding to two different numerators. I also discussed here already this efficient implementation of the drift. So we saw that if the matrix of the correlation structure has low rank, it's possible to implement the drift way faster, yeah, by rewriting the formula. Yeah? So you can gain a factor of 10 or a factor of 20 or whatever, depending on what is the relation of the number of interest rates you are simulating and the number of factors in the correlation matrix. But I skipped here this small discussion of the short period bond. And I would like to devote the first smaller part of this lecture to this. And then I will discuss of the discretization and Monte Carlo simulation and start discussing here the implementation. We will have a look at code. Yeah, so in the numerical methods lecture, maybe you remember, sometimes I wrote code live. So this is maybe not possible here because it is it's a bigger framework, but we will go through a lot of steps, yeah, from time discretization to Brownian motion to Euler scheme to whatever the model with the drift and finally the financial product. This is one possible way of designing this. Yeah, and there's no best solution. Yeah, but you can just think of it as being one example how to structure, how to cut things into smaller parts in a reasonable, hopefully reasonable way. But before I start this, I would like to go back and let's have a look at this short period bond. When we discussed the model in the derivation of the drift, there were different numerators that I considered. One example was the spot measure. And recall here, the spot measure we used as the numerator, the strategy which always invests in the bond that matures at the end of the next period. So if this here is then the time discretization that discretizes your interest rate curve, so later the time discretization that discretizes the Euler scheme can be different. It should be that interest rate curve discretization is part of it, so it should be maybe it could be finer, yeah. But it can be different. So if this here is the discretization of our tenor, so of the interest rate periods, then our numerator consisted of, so for example, if this here is little t, then we invested in the bond that pays 1 unit at the end of the period. And then when we moved to the next period, so when we moved beyond this point, yeah, we invested in the next bond. So we took out all the money we got. So we took out all the money we got is actually the accrual, yeah, of this account. Yeah, so this is what we gain by accruing over every period. And then we invest this into the short period bond. So there is this object here in our model. It's part of the numerator. And the funny thing is that our model only models the quantities LJ. So the model only knows interest rates for these periods here. Yeah, so we only know the interest rate for this period. And I never specified what is this short period bond. Yeah? So this information was missing from the model. The funny thing is that we didn't need this in the derivation of the drift. So on this short period bond, the short period bond appears in the numerator. Actually, if you also look in the definition of the other numerator, the terminal measure, then you see it is not so obvious, but to some extent, this bond is somewhere inside there. So this unspecified bond occurs in our numerator, actually in both numerators. And for the derivation of the drift, it was not necessary to specify the stochastic process of this object. Yeah? So for the modeling of the forward rates, it was not relevant to specify this. So this short period bond was not relevant. Okay, so why was that? So if we go back to where we derived the drift, so here we have chosen the numerator. So deriving the drift, yeah, the reason was that, or the approach was that we take a ratio of a traded asset divided by the numerator. And here the traded asset was the bond that matured at some time index I. So if I draw again here my tenor discretization, yeah, so here are now some intervals, yeah, and maybe this here is TI, yeah, so then we have the bond that matures in TI, so this guy here, so this guy pays 1 unit here, okay, and we have our numerator, yeah, so and observe this at a point little t, say for example here. So now if we are in terminal measure, so the probability measure that pays 1 unit at the end, yeah, so that is not the one for which the drift is paid here or derived here. So then for terminal measure, okay, then it goes on here, there is some Tn here. Dividing these two, we see that these periods here up to time little t are contained in both assets, and hence these periods before the line ti are cancelled. So these are cancelled. And in terminal measure, it's only this part that remains in this ratio. So now here, this was the numerator for spot measure. So let's have a look at spot measure. So then the numerator is some constant multiplied with the bond that matures here at the end of the period. Okay, so that is our numerator here. Okay, and of course there is some constant that comes from the past, yeah, the amount that we have accrued, but inside our bond that is used to derive the drift, yeah, or to derive the equation from which we then can derive the drift, you see that this bond here is actually this interest rate 1 plus L times period length, yeah, to the power of minus 1 multiplied with this interest rate here, so 1 plus L, and then also that one. And you see that the two indeed also cancel here. Yeah? So they cancel. So in the derivation of the drift, that part, the short period bond, fall out of the equation, and the drift only depended on the specification of the forward rates on our discretization. Okay, so that was nice. However, yeah, there's still some gap in our model. Yeah? So, and what is this gap? So, first, if you go back to the equation that defines the numerator, you see that it's not possible to know the numerator at arbitrary times because I need this object for the numerator. But at the time discretizations, I have that this part here is 1, and the numerator is only a function of the L, so of our forward rates. So our model has somewhat a gap. The numerator is not known in between the period discretization used for the interest rate curve. So we only know the numerator at these points. If we would like to know the numerator in between, we need this object here. So we need this short period bond. So is this a big problem? Well, maybe not, because if you have an interest rate derivative that pays only at one of these times here. So if you have an interest rate derivative where payments only occur at this discretization points, then I don't need the numerator in between. Yeah. So the numerator is needed at payment date. So usually. So that model, without modeling this part here, already covers a large amount of interest rate derivatives, namely all interest rate derivatives that reference these rates on our time discretization and have payment dates on the time discretization. And of course, you can make the time discretization finer. So you look at your financial product, and if a financial product has finitely many payment times, then you can choose a time discretization where the numerator is known. So our model does not describe the stochastic process of the short period bond. Yeah. So it does not describe how this object behaves. We only know the forward rates. So there's a certain gap in the model. Well, other models, for example, short rate models, they model the short rate, and then if you take a very fine time discretization for the stochastic process, actually, depending on which model you have, you sometimes have an analytic formula for the bond prices. They allow to calculate all forward rates for arbitrary starting times and arbitrary end times. Yeah. So obviously these models then don't have the defect, yeah, that they have a discretization of the interest rate curve, and they also have the information of this short period bond. So the short period bond and fractional forward rates, they are somewhat related. So I need this object here to make some statement of a rate where the starting point of the period and the end point, or the end point of the period, is not in our discretization. So when starting point or end point is not in the discretization, then I need more information about this short period bond. So another defect of our model is that, in addition to not knowing the numerator, it is that we maybe do not know what is the interest rate here in this period, or what is the interest rate in this period. Yeah. So these guys are not specified. The single specification of the short period bond will also specify how you can interpolate these rates. Okay, so that is another nice insight. So it is one object that is missing. And this here is the missing object. And once you have described this missing object for all times, you also know the interpolation for all rates. Okay, why is that? Because such a rate here is just the ratio of two zero coupon bonds. Namely, the zero coupon bond that pays here, say, at the end of the period, and the zero coupon bond that pays here at the beginning of the period. And valuing a zero coupon bond is just one divided by the numerator. Since this short period bond here completes the definition of the numerator, it also completes the definition of all forward rates, yeah? Because one divided by numerator with this time, and one divided by numerator with this time, taking expectation, yeah, I can calculate this rate. So you see that it's not that you have to specify the interpolation for all intervals, or the rates for all intervals. It's just that you have to specify one missing quantity, namely this financial product here. The bond that matures at the end of the period observed at the current time. And now you also see a little bit the link to a short rate model. A short rate model only specifies a single quantity, the rate which I observed today. But since it specifies this quantity and the numerator can be derived from this quantity, and it specifies this quantity under the risk neutral measure, so that's a very special situation. Yeah, you know all interest rates by taking expectation. Okay, so this guy here has a special role. Yeah, it not only completes the definition of the numerator, it also defines how in between rates are given. There is a very easy choice to complete this model, which we have described. Yeah? So our LIBOR market model. And that choice is, I assume that this bond here has zero volatility. Yeah? So if it has zero volatility, then it means that the process has no DW part. So it's just some deterministic function. And I know, for example, the value of this process at a special time. So PT MT plus one. Observed in little t, for little t being the starting point, yeah, is equal to, so this is equal to PTI plus one observed in TI. And this is just 1 divided by 1 plus Li delta TI observed at the beginning of the period. So maybe I write this in a new line so I can write it correctly. Yeah, so this is just 1 plus Li observed in TI delta TI to the power of 1 because it is 1 divided by. So you can just do some kind of linear interpolation, assuming, so it is 1 divided by a linear interpolation, assuming that this rate here is constant. Yeah, you could just say, okay, I define this object here as something, okay, where do I write this here? So possible choice. So possible simple choice for this short p-bit bond would be to say, okay, I just take the interest rate, which I observe at the beginning of the period. Yeah, so I define this and take this rate to be constant and apply it to the period, to the remaining period. Yeah, so pti plus 1 minus ti, and there's a 2 to the power of minus 1 here. That would be a choice that fulfills this this property. Yeah, so it is just so between ti and ti plus 1, yeah, so there's no volatility because this guy here is looks like a stochastic process, but actually it is fixed at the beginning. So it's just a constant, and it's just a function of little t. So in this special choice where this has zero volatility, yeah. So then you have completed your model, and you have defined an interpolation. And this choice here coincides with a Heath-Jerome-Morton framework where the volatility structure has a very special shape. Yeah? The volatility of each forward rate is some parameter, but shortly before the period, the volatility drops to zero. Since this is only in between a period, so it's only at the end of the time span, of the lifespan of a forward rate, maybe this is not such a bad approximation. Yeah. So that is an easy way of completing this model. So now I already told you about interpolation. I wanted to do this in a separate session, but just to give you an idea. If you define the bond like this here, you can derive the drift. Yeah? The drift is the differential of this with respect to t, with respect to time. But actually the drift of this short period bond is a free parameter. I do not have a restriction on what is the drift of this object. Well, we derive the drift of the forward rates by taking ratios, zero copper bond maturing in TI divided by our numerator, has to be a martingale. And this is a restriction on the drift. So how is this here? So if you look at the short period bond and you like to do the same, yeah, so you like to calculate the drift of the short period bond, you see that there's no restriction because in this expression traded asset divided by the numerator, the short period bond cancels out. Yeah, so it is part of the numerator and it's part of the asset which I'm looking at. And this is always a martingale, yeah, independent of the drift of this bond. There is, of course, some kind of restriction. If my short period bond is, for example, a process with zero volatility, yeah, so it is a deterministic function, yeah, so like in this this example here. Yeah. So then it is just a function and the drift, yeah, it's just a function of time. So here we have time. And the drift is just the slope of this function. And so, well, maybe say here we have the next discretization point. So this is here TMT. Yeah. So then you know maybe this value here, you know this value. And then you also know the interest rate for this period here, because the interest rate for this period, if this here is, for example, one, I know that the bond has value one at the end, then the interest rate for this red period is the ratio of, say, bond at the end divided by bond at the beginning. So the ratio one divided by this value is one plus the interest rate. So these values here are known, yeah. So maybe the I draw them in green, yeah. So you know that the bond has to be one at the end, and the bond has a certain value at the beginning. But the drift, so the slope of the curve in between, is a free parameter. Of course, there is some restriction, yeah, some restriction. You know that the guy has to start here, and it has to end there. Yeah. So the slope can change. And also maybe it should be monotone, yeah, because if you don't like negative interest rates in between, then you have another restriction. If you allow negative interest rates in between, then it is allowed to be non-monotone. Yeah. So you can impose some restrictions, but you see that the drift in between has no restriction. The integral of the drift, starting from MT, ending in MT plus one, has a restriction. So I only have a restriction on the integral. So also there's a nice relation now to short rate model and other interest rate models. So at this point, it may be a surprise that there's no restriction on the drift, but we already observed this. In the Black-Scholes model, for example, the drift R was a free parameter. Yeah, so the drift R was a free parameter because it was the parameter entering in the numerator. It was the drift of the numerator. And under the risk neutral measure, the stock also had the drift R. And this was then the condition that S divided by B was a numerator, but R was a free parameter. So R was giving us the shape of the interest rate curve. And also here, this is actually, this drift here in between is actually the shape of the interest rate curve for in between rates. Okay, so the drift of this short period bond is the interest rate curve for the points where we do not have discretization points. All the others are the initial values for the forward rates. So you see somehow how this relates and why this short period bond is a nice object, an interesting object, although in the derivation of the model, it drops out and it doesn't appear. So we need this object to define the numerator and to define the interpolation. And the drift of this object is determined by the shape of the interest rate curve for this of this interpolation. Yeah, that was the short period bond. So I already had a discussion on the implementation of the drift term, on the efficient implementation of the drift term, so I can skip this. And now I like to move on and talk a little bit about now the implementation, the numerical implementation of our model. So our model is a big model now. So of course, later we will derive analytic formulas, because analytic formulas are sometimes nice or needed to calibrate the model fast. Yeah, because an analytic formula is faster than a numerical method. But currently, I'm just looking at numerical methods. So last time I already mentioned, we have three phases. We have financial products that can be valued just by observing prices on the market without a model. We have financial products that can be valued using a model and an analytic formula derived from the model. So the model is so simple that we can derive an analytic formula. And now I would like to create a big general model where I don't care about deriving an analytic formula because I just want to have a model that describes everything more or less precise. And we have to then refrain to numerical methods. Okay, so given that our model is an ETO process, we can use all the methods that have been derived in, for example, lecture on numerical methods and apply it here. So I will give a short review or point you to these steps. So of course, the two elements that enter here are the Monte Carlo method and the Euler scheme or some numerical scheme similar to the Euler scheme for the time discretization. The Monte Carlo method is also very suitable here for this model because it is high dimensional. I already mentioned that here our variable L, Li, is a vector of random variables or random vector in, say, for example, 40, 80, 100 dimensions, because the dimension is now given by the time discretization of our interest rate curve. And so from this remark that for the numerator, maybe you have to have a fine discretization at every payment date, you immediately see that it can become very high dimensional. So I write now the model in this form with the parameter lambda I here. So when I started, it was sigma I dwi, and dwi dwj had a certain correlation. But in this small session on the efficient derivation of the drift, you saw that it's maybe nice to rewrite the correlation using, for example, a Cholesky decomposition or whatever, with these factors. So I assume there is a matrix of factors, Fik, such that the sum, so the scalar product of the vector Fi and the vector Fj, so the sum from k from 1 to m, Fik, Fjk, models here the correlation. Then I can write the coefficient in front of the Brownian motion is sigma I Fik, and the Brownian increment can be written as the sum lambda ik dwk, where I now assume that the dwk, dwl are uncorrelated, so independent Brownian increments. Previously, so a small remark so that you don't get confused here. Previously, I used here the letter U for the independent increments, and I used the letter W for the correlated ones. So it was dw I is the sum ik, sum fik duk. So, but now I use the letter W here for the independent ones. So I use the letter W. Because also in my implementation, the U and the W, this difference doesn't appear. I only have a Brownian motion that generates independent elements. And then we will introduce the correlation using this. So this here is our model. And this part here with the lambda I is somewhat like a model within the model that specifies the correlation structure. And this sigma I here is the volatility coefficient. Of course, all these guys depend on time. So there is an off T. And this drift here depends, of course, on the numerator. So which numerator we choose. And it was a complicated function, a function of all the L's. Yeah, that is now our model. And here I write sometimes to keep notation short a scalar product. So this is a scalar product. So lambda I is a vector of lambda ik, and dw is a vector of dwk. And this here is then a scalar product, lambda ik, dwk, take the sum. So if I use this dot here, it's a scalar product, and I can write everything a little bit shorter. Then recall that we had the Euler scheme for discretizing stochastic processes. So here is a stochastic process that I like to discretize. Yeah, so it looks exactly as our model. So it has a parameter mu for the drift, a parameter lambda for the factor loading. So mu and lambda can depend on the state variable. Well, the Euler scheme for such an ITO process, very simple. You assume that the coefficients are constant over time intervals of a given time discretizations. Yeah? So you assume that the coefficients are just frozen. And then you just integrate over this time interval, and integral over dt becomes the delta t, and integral over dw becomes the delta w. And then you have the integral over this time interval gives you the difference of the stochastic process at the end. Yeah, so integral over dy is the difference of yti plus 1 and yti. So move this yti here to the other side, and you have the new value is the previous value plus the frozen drift coefficient multiplied with the time step, and the frozen factor loading multiplied with the Pond increment. And again, there's here this scalar product, yeah, because this is actually here a sum over many elements. So this is just the Euler scheme. Very, very intuitive, very easy. And we had a small review at the beginning of this lecture, yeah, so you can look it up in the script. And maybe you remember that with the Euler scheme, we get some kind of discretization error because we freeze the coefficient. So if we go back here, you see that this coefficient here depends on the stochastic process. Yeah. And if you have, for example, log normal process, there is here some sigma times L times dW. So freezing this coefficient at the beginning of the time discretization interval introduces a discretization error. And for that reason, it is good to make these coefficients say as constant as possible. Yeah? Because if this is a constant, actually there's no discretization error. And making it as constant as possible, so if it depends on y, maybe that can be achieved by moving to a different coordinate system. And you see here, if I have a log normal model, then the coefficient in front of the dw is L times lambda dw. So for the log normal one, I have here something like this. Sorry, let's take the same color. I have here something like this. For the normal one, the coefficient is already nice, it doesn't depend on the L, yeah. And for this in-between guy here, the displaced log normal, the coefficient is like this. So I would maybe do the Euler scheme not on the original variable. I would like to do the Euler scheme on a transformed variable. For that reason, the specification of my Euler scheme is a little bit generalized. So this here is a generalized Euler scheme. And it's generalized in the sense that the stochastic process, which I like to discretize, is actually here the process X. and I move to a different variable, say, for example, the variable y, and I discretize the variable y, and then I transform the variable y to the variable x. So I write down the Euler scheme here below for the variable y. And the variable which I, the random variable which I'm interested in. So for example, my forward rates are here a function of y. So I transform here the discretized variable. I transform it back to some x. So this means in my implementation, a model not only consists of the model parameters, like for example, the initial value, the coefficient in front of the diffusion, the drift term. The model also consists of a transformation that maybe is specific to this model and transforms it to something which is numerical more more tractable. So here we have some examples. So if the model is in normal form, it's maybe already nice. Yeah, the coefficient in front of the DW is not depending on the forward rate. There's nothing to transform. If it is log normal, I take the exponential and I move to the log coordinates. Yeah, so the inverse transformation, F inverse, is the logarithm. And similar for the displaced diffusion model. Okay, so that was some review of the time discretization. Of course, all my objects are random variables, and I would like to do a Monte Carlo simulation. So in these equations, the delta W, the Brownian increments, they are approximated by sample vectors. So my Brownian increments, delta W J, yeah. So I have a vector delta W, depending on the number of factors. Yeah, you know that one possible way of generating normal distributed random vectors, yeah, random numbers, is to use uniform distributed random numbers and apply the inverse of the cumulative distribution function. So you take the inverse of the cumulative distribution function, so that is your phi inverse, apply it to a sequence of uniform distributed random numbers, then you get normal distributed random numbers, standard normal, and since the Brownian increment has variance delta ti, yeah, I have to scale it with the square root of delta ti. Okay, so these are the two numerical methods which we would like to use. Maybe let's go through this for the classical log normal model. Yeah, the classical log normal LIBOR market model or forward rate model. So our model is DLI is mu I Q superscript n. And now, okay, there was already that remark in the last lecture. For the log normal model, you can prove that you can represent the drift in the form mu I times Li. Yeah? So that is maybe not the same mu as I used in the derivation of the drift, because there I wrote it without the Li. So dt plus the sigma I L I D W I. So that's maybe the classical form, yeah, which you find in a textbook. Well, that you can have the L I here. Yeah, you have to prove it, but we proved it by deriving the drift. We saw that if there's an L I here, there's also an L I here. So I can write it in this form. And now I would like to write the model in this form where the correlation is represented by this factor loadings and a scalar product with some Pauling motion. So let's rewrite this part here in this different form. So there is the Li in front. There is the Li in front. And then there is the sum k from 1 to m. So we have m factors lambda I k dwk. Okay, so that's now the classical log normal model. And you see you have here an Li in front. So moving to the logarithm will kill this term here. So if we look now at the logarithm of Li applying Itô's lemma, we get exactly the form here on the right. So we get mu dt plus lambda I dw. And Itô's lemma tells us that we get a second order term, yeah, because the logarithm is a nonlinear function. So we get a second order term. And that is here the part minus 1/2 sigma I squared. So we get this term and minus 1/2 sigma I squared, but here I wrote minus 1/2 lambda I squared, taking the norm of lambda I. So why is that? So you know that lambda I k is just sigma I times f I k, okay? And the sum k from 1 to m, f I k, f j k is the correlation. Yeah, so these vectors f I, f k, yeah, the scalar product represents the correlation. So I know that the sum k from 1 to m, f I k, f I k, so the norm, the norm of f, I know that this is rho ii, so the correlation of the Brownian motion with itself, so that is 1. Yeah. So I know that the norm of f I squared is 1. So I know that the norm of lambda I squared is just equal to sigma I squared. Okay. Yeah, so you can take this sigma here in front of the norm. Yeah, sigma is positive. Yeah, sigma I squared, you get it in front. And you then just have the norm of Fik, of Fi, sorry. And that is 1. Okay, so now we have the model in log coordinates written in this lambda form, in this form with the factor loadings. Then you perform the discretization step. So now I perform the Euler scheme. So we perform the Euler scheme. And I get time discretization. So I write here L tilde. Yeah, because it is now an approximation. And then I move back to the original coordinates applying my function f. So this here is my function f, and this here is my function f inverse. And I get the scheme for the forward rates, for the approximated forward rates. In the special case where we are, for example, under a special numerair, so if Li is looked at under the numerair pti plus 1, so under the measure corresponding to the numerair pti plus 1, I know that this drift here is 0. So the discretization for, scheme simplifies a little bit. Yeah, the drift here is missing. And if now the factor loading. So the parameter in front of the delta W. So here, if this parameter can be integrated analytically. So now I define here the integral over the time interval from t to delta t. I integrate lambda I squared, so lambda I k squared, so I do it component wise. Yeah. If this is the case, then actually this here is the exact solution. So this guy here is the exact solution for the discretization scheme. I don't have a discretization error. So that's the reason why I move to the different coordinate frame, because I can reduce the discretization error if I do this. And maybe I should move to such a coordinate even if other parts still have a discretization error. So here I don't have a discretization error. So you see here I can write L, yeah, and not L tilde, it's the exact solution. And even in the case where this is not drift free, and you know the drift of your forward rate is a very complicated function with a lot of other forward rates appearing. Yeah, so I cannot find maybe a coordinate frame where this disappears. Well, there are methods that do this. Yeah, so-called arbitrage-free discretization. Yeah, so you can look this up. I also have a reference on this. Yeah. But in the case where you have the drift there, you can choose the discretization scheme maybe such that you don't have a discretization error here. Yeah? So here I use the lambda bar, which is the analytically integrated lambda. And here it's also the lambda bar. And the only discretization error is now coming here from the drift. Yeah? So the discretization error of this scheme here, the discretization error of this scheme here only comes from the drift part and not from the diffusion part. And maybe for the drift, there are numerical methods to even improve the discretization, yeah, the predictor corrector step, and so on. So, and actually, I should write here a tilde. Yeah, I told that, but here I'm not writing a tilde and just write L. Yeah. But in general, the drift cannot has a discretization error, so it is an approximation L tilde and it's not the true solution. This point here that sometimes you can replace the parameter by some integral over the time step of this parameter, this improves sometimes the numerical methods. And since these parameters later, they will be calibrated to market prices, and you cannot observe so many instruments on the market. So actually, this replacing the parameter here with a constant that serves for the full interval is maybe not such a big deal, because we even do not have enough information about this parameter. So often you assume that these parameters are piecewise constant functions. So it's maybe enough to assume that these parameters are piecewise constant functions. And in such cases, you can calculate this integral analytically. Yeah? So an integral of a piecewise constant function is just the sum, yeah, of all those small pieces with a fractional piece at the end. So in the case where my interval is just a subinterval of this of the pieces where the function is constant, then it's just the constant itself. Okay, so discretizing the parameter in terms of piecewise constant functions can be an advantage, because it will later reduce or allow us to reduce the discretization error of the numerical scheme. Of course, we have to then do the right integral here for the parameter. That was the time discretization, the generation of the sample paths. is, of course, just our Monte Carlo method. So generation of the sample passes means that we just draw random numbers using a random number generator, and this generates then the vector of increments, yeah, normally distributed increments, and then it generates the next representation of our forward rate. So actually the result of this numerical procedure is a three-dimensional object. So we have the forward rates here for every period. So the interest rate curve is discretized. Then we have that for a finite number of simulation time steps. So the simulation time is discretized. And we have it on a finite number of Monte Carlo passes. Now, so the space of Monte Carlo passes here is discretized. So usually you can use millions of passes and 1,000 rates. Yeah, so you have billions of objects. So that was the numerical method to generate DL. Of course, to finally value the financial derivative, we have to generate the numerator. Yeah? And the numerator is just a function of the L. So once we have the forward rates, so if we have the simulated interest rate curve for every simulation time step and every period, then we can calculate the numerator. And recall that we had this little issue with the short period bond. So as long as we don't prescribe the short period bond, we have the numerator only at specific dates, namely at the discretization dates of our interest rate curve. But at these dates, I have the numerator as a function of the forward rates. Under terminal measure, yeah, it is the bond that matures at the end of the time discretization. It's, for example, just this function here. So just a function of the forward rates. So I can calculate the numerator once I have generated all those realizations of the forward rate for all the times. So actually for the numerator, you see here, I only need the rate LJ also here at these times. Yeah? So there's no interpolation needed. That was the generation of the numerator. Yeah, so now let's have a start looking at the implementation. For the implementation, I will discuss now all the steps, all the ingredients we need to build this model. And since the implementation should reuse as much code as possible, and also separate the code into, say, modules or parts or object or whatever you like to name it, that can be maintained, yeah, without interfering with other objects, it's really good to start thinking about this. And here you also see that it's good if the programmer is also a good mathematician, because you have to have a feeling which part depends on which other part. And we will maybe see one or two small examples where you see that that a certain thing goes into a certain class, yeah, or module or whatever. This has some mathematical background. Well, to already mention this, for example, the Trift and the Numerea, they have to be close together because the choice of the Numerea determines the Trift. If these two things are in different modules, you can have easily something inconsistent. So the Trift and the Numerea, somehow they have to be in the same class. And this will also go back to this here, that the numerator is actually a function of the rates, yeah, which require the drift and so on. Yeah. So how do you design this? Here's everything on one slide. So our mathematical model here, the Itô process, together with the numerator. The numerator is a function of the rates, can be for the spot measure, a function of the past rates that accrue. It can be for the terminal measure, a function just of the interest rate curve observed at a fixed time. Yeah. But it cannot, of course, it does not depend on the interest rates at a future point in time, because then the numerator would not be FT measurable. So this here is our model. And here I have on one slide our discretization. So we allow that the discretization is performed on a transformed variable. Then the transformed variable will be discretized using an Euler scheme. And the discretized variable will be back transformed to the original coordinates. So what do I need to do this? So the first ingredient is, of course, I need a time discretization for my time discretization scheme. So maybe this time discretization here, the job to provide a time discretization should be part of one class, a class that provides time discretization. That's maybe a very small thing, but this class can do some handy stuff. For example, it can calculate also here the steps, yeah, or it can calculate this function m of t. So the function m of t was the index of the period, yeah, so the largest index for which the time is smaller than the given time, yeah. So something like this. So there's something to do. So we need a time discretization. Then the next ingredient is, of course, the Brownian increment. So we are looking at Itô processes. So here we have an Itô process. So there is a Brownian increment, and the Brownian increment is the place where we generate random numbers and transform them to normal distributed random numbers, where we generate uniform random numbers, transform them to normal distributed random numbers. So this is the place where the numerical method related to Monte Carlo is located. If you do pseudo random numbers, quasi random numbers, yeah, quasi Monte Carlo, pseudo Monte Carlo. So this is the place where this code should be. So maybe having one class that is responsible for generating Brownian increments is a good idea. Yeah? So this here is the Brownian motion. Brownian increments. So that's maybe something you should separate and have it in one place. So now maybe it's getting a little bit more tricky. Yeah. So I have the Euler scheme here. So this here is my Euler scheme. Maybe I just draw a box instead of coloring everything. So the Euler scheme takes the Brownian motion as an ingredient. It also takes the time discretization, and it calculates the next value from the previous value. Well, it needs something else. It needs the model. So maybe I should separate the numerical scheme and the model. So this here is the Euler scheme. The Euler scheme also does the transformation to the original coordinate. So maybe I view this here also as a part of the Euler scheme. So I write a general scheme that performs the Euler scheme on some hidden state variable and transforms it back. So what are the parts needed by the Euler scheme? So the parts needed by the Euler scheme are now everything that describes our model. So what describes our model? Our model is, of course, described by the diffusion parameters, the factor loadings, the initial value. Okay, so this is describing our model. So that should be part of a specific class providing the model. The initial value. And I already drawn the mu, yeah. So the model is also specified by the mu. So the model should also maybe know under which measure I'm simulating. And since the model has maybe the knowledge about am I a log normal model, am I a normal model? So since the model has the knowledge about this function here, maybe the model should also specify what is the best coordinate frame which you should use in the discretization. So I would place here this F also in the model. You see that here there is on top a Y. Yeah. So this lambda here and this mu is not the same lambda and mu as here, yeah, because I have transformed to a different coordinate frame. So if this is a log normal model, there will be a lambda times L here, and there's no lambda times L here if this is here the logarithm and this here is the exponential function. Yeah, and this drift here will have a minus 1/2 sigma squared if I transformed to the log coordinates. So you see that the drift and this function, this transform you use, are also linked together. So the class that provides the drift should also be the class that provides this function. So all the blue parts here, I view them as the model. So this is the specification of the model. The model which we are simulating. Okay, so, and of course, everything that you see here on the slide is written in terms of random variables. So everything can be a random variable. So even if mentioned that there are models for which lambda is just a constant, yeah, Black-Scholes model in log coordinates or Bachelier model, yeah, then you have here, this is just a constant. Even then, I would just consider it as a random variable. Okay, then it's a deterministic random variable. So all the objects here are random variables. So that is another part of my design. I have classes representing random variables. So I will introduce an interface representing random variables. So everything here is a random variable. Okay, so you see from this picture, there are certain parts which maybe should go into a separate implementation. And in order to separate the implementation, the tool I use are interfaces. So interfaces is the collection of operations you can do with the object, the specification of the operation you can do with the object without specifying the concrete implementation. So later we can change the implementation. Here the random variable is a very nice example, which we have already covered. So I will now define everything in terms of the interface of a random variable. Then we can choose whether we use just a normal vector or floating point numbers, and everything here will be just vector arithmetic, or if we use an algorithmic differentiation random variable, and which then allows to calculate derivatives, yeah, partial derivatives of the results. Yeah. So this is a big model, and we can later inject this code with very little effort if we have from the beginning worked with the interface. And also here with the Brownian motion, yeah, this will also be an interface when the Euler scheme uses it. So it uses a Brownian motion, but it doesn't know how the Brownian motion is implemented. And we can later exchange this by creating random numbers in a different way. Yeah, so quasi-random numbers creating quasi Monte Carlo method, creating a quasi Monte Carlo integrated interest rate model. Yeah? So we separate this aspect by defining here an interface. And since the model is so rich, actually this part here will be an interface of its own. Yeah, the model for the covariance of the rates, and later we can create all kinds of interest rates, like a discretized version of the short rate models, Hull-White model, Ho-Lee model, or whatever. Yeah. So these will be many classes. Let's go through some of them and have a look at some of them. So the first thing that was on my slide, it was the orange one, is the random variable. So the random variable, our interface is the random variable. You know this interface from our session on algorithmic differentiation, or other sessions we had. So the interface is somewhere hidden here, and it's just a specification of arithmetic operations that can be done. Yeah, so there are subtraction. You can calculate the difference of two random variables, the sum of two random variables, and so on. Yeah? So this is just plugging in some object that represents a field on which operations can be performed. And then the Euler scheme will be written in terms of this interface. And an implementation of this interface is just here in our Monte Carlo method. So if we lose Monte Carlo, then it could be just a floating point array, and everything is an element-wise operation. So you see that even on this basic level here, you can decide, for example, the precision of the floating point operations. Yeah, you can decide this by throwing in different implementations of our random variable interface. So this allows us here to have different floating point accuracies. We can use something fancy like algorithmic differentiation by throwing in another class implementing this. Or we could even throw in a random variable which performs the arithmetic on a graphic card. Yeah? So we could maybe also throw in something that performs the calculation on the GPU. You can do all kinds of fancy stuff. So this technique, by writing your algorithm in terms of an interface and then later throwing in different implementations, is called dependency injection. Yeah. So the Euler scheme depends on how random variables are multiplied, added, and so on. And you inject this dependency into the algorithm. So this this dependency injection is a very powerful tool, but you have to consider it from the beginning in your design. My next object on my slide was the time discretization. So the time discretization that was marked in, I believe, green I used here. So there has to be some interface for a time discretization, and this is some trivial stuff maybe, but you can implement the map that maps an index to a time. You can implement also the map that maps a time back to the nearest index, the largest index for which the time discretization is smaller, and so on. Yeah, so some mappings from time to index, and you can also implement this. Yeah, so there's also some implementation of the time discretization somewhere floating around here. It's a bit trivial. So there is time here, and you have a time discretization interface here, which just specifies some handy, some nice functions. Yeah, so get the time step, get the time, or get the index for a given time, get the index nearest, less or equal, and so on. Okay, and an implementation is this time discretization here, which is just a floating point array. And it can do some rounding, yeah, to some nearest point. So this guy here is called time discretization from array. So actually this here is a small typo. This is the name is from array. So the next thing on my slide was the Brownian motion. So the next thing I have to define is the Brownian increment, the delta W. Yeah. So we have an interface called Brownian motion. So this interface just specifies that I can get a sample vector for the Brownian motion. So that is here in Monte Carlo. So there's the Brownian motion. And you see, it somehow depends on my time discretization. Yeah? So you can ask the Brownian motion for the time discretization. So this is a time discretized Brownian motion. So you get a time discretization. So you only get the interface here. Yeah? So you don't get a specific implementation. And you can ask for the Brownian increment. So the Brownian increment is our delta W. Yeah? So if you move here, yeah, maybe you see it a little bit nicer. Yeah? So the Brownian increment is our delta W. And you get this in terms of a random variable. And I don't know which implementation of random variable is used. So somehow the Brownian motion injects a certain implementation of the random variable. So there are different implementations. For example, here is one using the Mersenne twister as a random number generator. And you also see that you can inject here a random variable factory. So you can inject the type of random variables that are generated by this Brownian motion. So if you like to have an algorithmic differentiable Euler scheme, you create a Brownian motion that uses Mersenne random numbers with a given time discretization. And here you inject your algorithmic differentiation factory. So the factory that generates algorithmic differentiable objects. So the Brownian motion only generates the random numbers and wraps it into a certain implementation of the random variable. Okay, so you can look, the code here is just the inversion of the distribution function. Yeah, so I create here with Mersenne twister a uniform distributed random variable, and then I transform it to a normal distributed one. And here it is wrapped using this random variable factory into the random variable. So, that was the Brownian motion. The next thing is the Euler scheme. Yeah, on my slide where I tried to sort everything a little bit, that was a dark green. Yeah, so the time discretization was a lighter green. That was a dark green. So the Euler scheme generates the time discrete process. Yeah, so it generates L I at tj, of course, in terms of a random variable. The Euler scheme requires the Brownian motion, so we need the Brownian motion as an input. I have an implementation here of an Euler scheme, which also can do a predictor-corrector step. The interface is just an interface that provides a time discretized process. So the interface is just a very simple thing that provides a time discrete process. A time discrete process. So this is what this interface for this class provides. And here I have an implementation which provides this, but requires a Brown in motion, and it also requires the model. So the model on my slide was blue. So I need all the model parameters to create the Euler scheme. So I need mu lambda f. Actually, I also need f inverse, and I need the initial value. So where's the initial value? It's missing. So let's write it here. So, and the initial value Li0. So this stuff, the model, should be provided by some class representing the model. Of course, now I define an interface. I define an interface that has a method get factor loading, which is just give me lambda, get the drift, get this transformation, get the initial value. And everything which I get is, of course, a random variable. So yeah, in terms of my interface. So that's the next interface which I specify. This is the model. It is called here process model because it is the model for the time discrete process. So this model was blue on my slide. So the next interface I'm specifying is my process model. Sometimes I also have a little bit more specific interfaces, Monte Carlo process. For example, for Monte Carlo, you could ask what is the number of passes used. Yeah. Well, actually, I believe you should not use this, but sometimes I have an interface that provides a little bit more information. Okay, so this model is specifying here the parameters. And these two guys here, the Euler scheme, the process, and the model, the process model, the parameters, they operate a little bit together. So I specify for this Euler scheme the process. So just pointing you to where you find this. So inside the package Monte Carlo, there is a separation here in process and model. In process, you find, of course, also our Euler scheme. So you see the Euler scheme requires as an input this model, and it requires the Brown in motion. Actually, this Brown in motion here is just independent increments because this Euler scheme can also generate jump processes or other stuff. Yeah. So this guy here is just a base class for Brown in motion. It's just a more general interface. But it requires here this model. And if we look at the model, so you find some specification of this model, you see that this process model is just providing all the stuff that was marked in blue. So the initial value or the initial state, yeah, so it is in terms of the variable y. It provides the drift. It provides the factor loadings. Yeah, so this here is the mu, and this here is the lambda. And it provides this state space transformation. So this is the function f, the inverse, and the function f. Okay, so that's the model. And you see that we have many different implementations of the model. So there is the classical equity stuff for a stock. There is some short rate models that can be discretized with an Euler scheme. And there is also our forward rate models, labor market models. And to conclude this session, we will continue on the implementation for model and products. Here, just now, the important remark you saw in my specification of the interface that the model provides the drift. But if the model provides the drift, actually, it should know the numerator because the drift changes if you change the numerator. So it's good practice to specify that the interface that provides the drift also provides the numerator. So going back here, it also provides the numerator n. So this class has to provide the numerator. And now there's a subtle thing. This model is used by the Euler scheme to generate our stochastic process. But for our LIBOR market model or for our interest rate model, if we go back, the numerator is a function of these quantities. So now I have two objects. One object needs the other to generate the values, but the other value object should provide the numerator as a function of these values. So how do we do this? So of course, the numerator is a function of this process. So for that reason, this process here is just the first argument of the numerator to allow to specify the numerator as a function of the stuff that is generated by this process. Okay, and we can continue discussing this these implementation details in the next session. Yeah, and just maybe then look a little bit deeper in how I calculate the drift. You see the efficient implementation of the drift, all the stuff which we have discussed. Yeah, so the implementation of our interest rate model is then part of the next section. Yeah, thanks.